supposed to be last week because it wasn't what it was. And so when I was coming up with this, we were talking about Jesus Feeds the 5,000. And so I literally put a placeholder title on my sermon called Catchy Title about Fish and Bread. And then I thought that was actually kind of a funny, clever title unintentionally, so I left it. So we're going to talk about that today. So I'm just going to open prayer, and we'll get to it. Dear God, thank you so much for today. Thank you that we're able to come together, or we have the freedom to come together as your church, and worship you, and celebrate you, and worship you. And Lord, I thank you for the opportunity today to speak your word, and please bless the words that I offer as humble as they are. Please allow someone to get to know you just a little bit better, at least from this morning, and possibly go eat fish and bread later. In your name, amen. So this morning we're going to talk about the miracle that everybody knows. Everybody knows this one. It's actually one of the only miracles to appear in all four Gospels, and it would probably look differently if you I'm going to say this at the outset. Look at the screen a lot during the sermon because of the images. Everything I say is going to be up there. So if you read through your Bible, great. But every verse is going to be up there. We're going to be looking at the verses total, and then we're going to be breaking them down literally verse by verse. So if Jesus was doing that sermon like that miracle today, it probably might be pizza instead of fish and loaves and stuff. But this is the only one that actually, one of the only ones that appears in all four Gospels. So we're going to read through it together, and then we're going to go verse by verse through it, and then we're going to just unpack it a little bit, and then you guys are going to go home and have some awesome food, I'm sure. Maybe fish and bread. So we're going to start. So this is John chapter 6, and we're starting verse 1. So sometime after this, Jesus crossed from the far shore of the Sea of Galilee, that is the Sea of Tiberias, and a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the miraculous signs he had performed on the sick. Then Jesus went up on the mountainside and sat down with his disciples. Now the Passover, the feast of the Jews, was at hand. Lifting up his eyes then, and seeing that a large crowd was coming towards him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we going to buy bread so that these people may eat?" He said to him, "You sent us to test him, for he himself knew what he needed." Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread would not be enough for each of them to get a little. One of those disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. Well, what are they for so many?" Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." Now, there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down, about 5,000 in number. Jesus then took the loaves and went. He had given thanks and distributed them to those who were seated, so also the fish, as much as they wanted. And when they had eaten their fill, he told his disciples, "Gather up the leftover fragments that none may give us." So he gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with fragments from the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten. And when they had saw the sign he had done, they said, "This is indeed the prophet who is coming from." So, who here knows that story? Who's heard it before? Put your hand up if you've heard that story before. Almost everyone, like most people, even if they've never read the Bible, have heard a lot about the loaves and fishes. So I actually preached on this a couple of years ago, a year and a half ago. They just wanted me to do John, so we literally talk about this section in 30 seconds because everybody knows it. But I'm going to get into it a bit deeper today. It's not going to be too long, but just we're going to kind of look at it in more details. We're literally going to go through verse by verse. So now we're going to break down. So we have this picture up here. And the reason this is up here is because it says, after this, this is how it starts, but after what? And so when you're reading the Bible and you start a verse where you're going, after this, after what? So you're always going to go back again. And so the reason his ears are this is because people weren't listening. So if you go to the next slide. Right before this, Jesus was talking to a bunch of Jewish people, many of them religious leaders. And they wanted was trying to explain who he was, and they weren't getting it. And he basically said to them, "What? You guys claim to be big on people, big on God because of Moses. Because the Jewish people had much like history, and they were very proud of that history." And he's like, "You guys claim to be big stuff because of Moses." And he's like, "Moses talked about me. Moses literally talked about me. But you don't want to listen to Moses. And you're not doing what you're supposed to do because Moses told you to do these things. And you're not doing that. You're not listening to the basic stuff. You're not listening to me." So with that, we're going to go in. So that's what happened right before. So it says, after that, we will verse 1. So John starts out with a location. John's really good at this. He actually like gives you clarification where Jesus was. So it says, after this, people aren't listening to him. Jesus went away to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, which is on the Sea of Tiberias. So literally, Jesus was like, if you're not going to listen to me, that's fine. And after this, Jesus goes away. So he literally goes to the other side of the sea. So that's the location you get. So, and no, that's okay, go to the next one. And so right after that, it says a large crowd was following him because they saw signs that he was doing on the sick. Now it's supposed to be 5,000 plus people. So that looks like a lot of people. I wouldn't count it. But there's a reason people were following him, because they wanted him to heal them. Now, moving to Nova Scotia almost a year ago, I understand this because Nova Scotia healthcare is not the best. I went to the hospital a little while ago because I wasn't feeling well, and after being there for like 13 hours, they just said, you know, it's probably okay. And so I totally get why they followed Jesus into the desert to try and get some healthcare. Because it was probably worse than it is in Nova Scotia. So, with that, Jesus went up to the mountain and sat in there. He sat down with the disciples. Now, I'm gonna tell you, I was a little sad because I was trying to put this sermon together, and I read this verse, and I was like, I want to get a cool picture of Jesus, and I want to find him. And I thought, you go to Google, you'll find anything. And I was like, I want to find a picture of a picture of Jesus in mountain climbing gear. And there isn't one. And I was like, this would be really funny to throw up on the screen. No mountain climbing pictures of Jesus. Very disappointing. I had one so far as to download an app that would make pictures for you, and it didn't make me a picture. It just showed a picture of a guy walking up the mountain. And I was like, I want to have like, the full harness of climbing the helmet and all that stuff. But anyways, so him and his disciples went up on the hill, sat down. And then verse 4, this is Paul giving, or John, sorry, John giving context here. It says, now the Passover, the feast of the Jews, was at hand. Now we, like back then, everybody understood that. So I'm going to give you a quick breakdown of what Passover was, if you don't. The Passover was a festival that the Jewish people did. Because back in the day, I don't know if you saw, there was a film called The Ten Commandments of Charlton Heston. And, what the Passover is the Jews were in Egypt, and they wanted to go, and they didn't want them to go. And so they did this thing, God's like, okay, let them go. And they went, so he's like, okay, frogs, no. Okay, boils, no. And then they went, okay, if you don't let us go, we're going to kill all your firstborn sons. And what they did is they literally went around to the doorposts of all the Jewish people and put blood on them, lamb's blood. And the Holy Spirit knew, don't kill those people, kill the people who have the blood on their doors. And that's called Passover. And that night they were only allowed to eat specific food. And this is the thing they did. And so the Jewish people have been celebrating this festival for a long time. And so this is some of the stuff they eat on Passover. They're only allowed to eat specific things. And they usually cover their doorposts with blood. So again, that was commonplace back then. He gives you the context of when this happened. So where it is, and this is about the time of Passover. Alright, next one we got. So lifting up his eyes, and then seeing that a large crowd was coming towards him, Jesus said to Philip, where will you buy bread so that these people may eat? So it's like simple question. Hey, Philip, disciples. Now this is the beginning of including the disciples. I like this. This is we're going to go back and back and back with this. So he goes, where are we going to get stuff to eat, Philip? And Philip's like, I don't know. So Next we go to, he said this to test him, for he knew what he would do. Now, I want you guys to understand this about Jesus if you don't know. Jesus was human and God, which meant he didn't sin, but Jesus had a sense of humor, and he was a little mischievous at times, I could say, mischievous at times. So he literally was like, hey man, where are we gonna get food from these people? And he knew exactly what he was gonna do. He was asking him to pop quiz, where are we getting food? And they're like, Jesus has got a little playful streak about that. So Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread would not be enough for each of us. Now, I looked it up as much as I could. That's roughly $12,000 in today's money. So if they had, I don't know, if any of you guys have $12,000 with you, and if you didn't come see me after, but most people don't have $12,000 in their pocket walking around. So, and plus there's no soapies anywhere close to where they are because they're up here in the mountain. So, what's a disciple to do? So, just then, one of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, says to him, and I'm pointing this out because this is one of the first times we see Andrew mentioned in the Bible, in the Gospels. So, partly that is because there's 12 disciples and they all don't get mentioned. Part of it is because when you're Peter's little brother, I'm assuming he's his little brother, because Peter gets all the talking points all the time, you don't get mentioned as much. So, he said to him, there's a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. Well, where are they for so many? So I'm sure this kid who was like walking amongst these people because he saw a crowd and like left home, his mom packed him a lunch that day. What are you doing? Why are these people chasing this man? And they came and was like, oh, you got food. What do you got? And I was like, oh, you know, I got 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. And, you know, they took it. So Jesus said to them, okay, we got 5 robbers. Have the people sit down. Now there was much grass in the place. So the men sat down, about 5,000 in number. Now, every sermon I've ever heard about this topic will tell you, I've heard lots, will tell you that the 5,000 number is only the men. So that doesn't include women and children. I am not telling you this. I'm just telling you that every sermon I've ever heard is telling this. I'm not talking about that today, but I'm just like, it's probably more, but I'm not saying every sermon I've ever heard is telling this. So you got to listen to that. Jesus then took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, so he prayed over them, which is awesome, he distributed them to those who were seated, and also the fish, as much as they wanted. Now the word I want you to keep on there is distributed. I want you to just kind of peg that one and highlight it for later in your brain. And then we go to the next one, and when they had eaten their fill, he told the disciples, gather up the leftover fragments, that nothing may be lost. So Jesus is all about saving things. It's this whole thing. And apparently that includes leftovers too. Who here likes leftovers? I routinely eat leftovers from my fridge. Really? Only like 4 of us. Wow, you guys. I like eating things that I've already eaten. It's easier to eat them up in the microwave than trying to make something from scratch. But yeah, Jesus doesn't want anything to be lost, so he's doing the same leftovers. So they gathered up them and filled 12 baskets with fragments from the 5 barley loaves left by those who. So that's a lot of leftovers, considering it's just, it was 5 barley loaves and 2 fish and 12 baskets. And I'm sure the kid was like, what the heck do I do with this? And then when the people saw the sign they had done, they said, this is indeed the prophet who has come to the world. So they were like, yeah, thumbs up, this guy's awesome. Which is nice, they were starting to get the picture, but they were missing like the point a lot of the time. But they're stripping it. So that's like the breakdown of the verses individually. So, as I said before, this was one of the only Gospels, or one of the only miracles, that all four Gospels talked about. Now, each one, if you read them side by side, which I have, are a little different. They're not majorly different, they're a little different because if you give four people the same information stylistically, they will write things down differently. If I was to write the same event down, and Matt was to write the same event, JT was to write the same event, and Kaiser in the background was to write the same event, I guarantee you it would be the same event, but you'd get little stylistic differences because I write differently than he does. So, but it's the only one. So, yet, only John out of the four, and I checked this also, I was like, I think it's the only one, ties the feeding the 5,000 into Jesus dying and for our sins. So he's like the only one that actually does it. But we're going to come back to that. Okay? First, I want to look at the whole thing and how it worked out. So, Jesus could have done this miracle in tons of different ways. He could have. There's this thing called manna that when the Israelites were in the desert years and years ago, this little flaky stuff came down and they could take it and make bread. So he literally could have had food drop from the heavens because he's God. He could have done this. Could have been miracles, could have just been manna, could have been anything, right? He could have done that way, okay? Or he could have filled everyone's bellies, just literally looked at the manna, then a snap, and everyone had food in their stomach, and they're all like, wow, that was filling. That was really good. So he could have done that. He didn't. But instead, he says to teach his followers, his disciples and all the people coming to him about himself. Okay, he wants to include them in this whole thing. That's why he asks the disciples, what should we do? Where can we get food from these people? Here are the new rules to do. But he wants to include them. And then he wants them to be part of solving our problems with them. And most of us don't know how to do that. And so we go, I don't know what to do. But that's generally what they did too. That's what disciples. So it's funny. Because Jesus is still doing that same thing today. He is literally partnering with disciples today. He did it then, he wants to do it now. And we have no clue how we're going to do things like spread the gospel. I get overwhelmed. Does anyone here get overwhelmed in this world? Real easy hands? Yeah, okay. JD, you're not overwhelmed ever. I get overwhelmed pretty easily, especially when I start thinking about like doing this or doing that, or like, you know, preaching. How am I gonna tell people my spin about Jesus more? And it's like, how am I gonna go to the church and how am I gonna do this? And there's all these things, and it's like, you need to calm down because it's not about me doing all these things. And this is what Jesus is trying to say, and he's trying to partner with you. So, Jesus didn't hand out, I guarantee you, Jesus didn't hand out, get everyone to sit down and then walk around to all 5,000 plus people and hand them each piece of bread. He broke the bread and then handed it out to the disciples. And the disciples gave it off. And then what did he say afterwards? The disciples, go gather all the bread. Right? So he didn't go do all this. He broke the bread, he blessed it, he broke the fish, and grabbed the great fish out. And blessed it, and then handed it out, and they distributed it, okay? It's that word, distributed, okay? So he's partnering with the disciples. Again, could have snapped everybody's bellies full, but he literally did this to show that I'm working with you, we're going to do this together. So, yeah, we tend to get overwhelmed with this stuff, and because of that, there's this verse, and this is part of why God wants to partner with us. Okay, so it says, for consider your calling, brothers. And this is 1 Corinthians 1, 27 to 29. It's just before 27 starts. So it says, for consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to the worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were noble. But God chose what is foolish in this world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in this world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing the things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. So the fact that we get overwhelmed with the fact that we can't do all these things by ourselves is kind of the point. Jesus doesn't want you to do all these things. He equips us to do lots of things. He's equipped me in different ways to hang out with young people and be able to help mentor them. And one of them's here because he's awesome. But he doesn't expect me to do everything himself, like myself. It's not all on me. And he's actually, I'll tell anyone, honestly, I'm not a strong person. I don't talk physically. We'll be all in super strong. But I have lots of weaknesses. For the people who don't know, I suffer from depression. So sometimes getting up in the morning, not the easiest thing to do. But God chooses the weak things in this world to show his power. So the fact that God can use me in all my frailty and all my problems literally shows how great he is and shows his greatness above that. So this brings me to my favorite part of our sermon. The reason you can do all these things is the gospel. I love preaching the gospel. And so, just in case someone in here has never heard the gospel before, I get to tell the gospel. So the gospel is, once upon a time, God made us, we were perfect, we screwed up and sinned. And if you're like, I never sinned, well, you've sinned, but like, this was back in the time. Back in the day, because I'm an old person, I can say that. Back in the day, our ancestors sinned and started this whole trend of us sinning. And we've been sinning ever since, because we thought, yeah, that's a good thing to do, but it's not. And so because of that, it separated us from God. And there was only one way to bridge that gap, which was God literally took human flesh, became human, lived a perfect life, and then died on the cross taking everybody's sin. Everyone in here, everyone in West Bay, everyone in Ontario, everyone in the rest of Canada, even Quebec. I'm saying, even Quebec. no slight Quebec, yeah, I was born there. But even everywhere, he took everyone's sin, past, present, future, when he did it, and took it upon himself. So all you need to do is basically go, you know what? Please forgive me. I accept you. And then you're in. And then you change your whole life because you're now part of the kingdom. You got that passport. We all have passports. If you travel, who has a passport? Because I have a passport. You two don't have passports that expire. I know that. You have a passport, Matt? Matt, you have a passport? Like, that's going to Toronto soon. But he doesn't need a passport to go to Toronto, it's not that far. But yeah, if you have a passport, it's from Canada. When you accept Jesus, now you have a passport to the kingdom of God. You're part of that kingdom. You're recognized as a citizen of heaven, you're a child of God, and that's what the gospel is. Jesus died for you so that you can be part of that community, you're part of his family, and he wants you to be part of the family. So if you've never heard of it before, talk to Jesus, talk to me, you, and anyone here that knows about Jesus. I'm glad they tell you more about him. It's one of my favorite parts of the sermon. I'm doing it for this. So, this brings you back to the miracle of breaking bread. So, Jesus later, the last time I preached on this, I actually preached, again, I talked about the fact that I did this 30-second thing on the 5,000, because I was talking all about this, and this is where it ties all together. So, Jesus later on is talking to a whole bunch of disciples that his main four guys, but he's also had all these people who literally, after he fed them, right after this, he walks on the water and does that miracle, where he walks on the water and is going somewhere else. All the people are like, where'd he go? And they follow him because they're like, that guy fed us. We should go. We should continue on and find him because you know what he'll do? Feed us again. And so they track him down. When they get there, he literally goes, okay, I get you want bread. And he's like, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread, and will hold it forever. This bread is my flesh, which I give for the life of the whole world. And here's the thing. In that chapter, people go, whoa, it's like, what are you talking about? They're like, you're going to sustain us. You're gonna do this. And a lot of people go, this is too hard to hear. And they walk away because they were literally just there for the bread. And he's like, I am the bread, and I'm going to be broken for you. And he was trying to explain. And so he was literally saying, I am broken for your sins, for your life. I'm the living bread. So Jesus broke bread for our bodies and allowed himself to be broken for our souls. And he wants you today to partner with him. He He wants you to accept that forgiveness, to live in that forgiveness, to know that that's who you are. And he wants literally to join his story and work towards making this world the kingdom of heaven that it was supposed to be. So the question is, today, are you going to be part of the story, or are you going to be a bystander who watches and hopes for bread, but then walks away when you don't get to bed? So that's what I got today. I'm so happy to be able to talk to you guys today about this. This week, I want you to look for opportunities to share bread with people. And I mean literal share bread with people. Share meals with them, break bread with people, but also, you know, be Jesus to people. Share Jesus with people. Do all the cool things about Jesus you can. Because it's going to be a very hot week from everything I've seen. So go inside a restaurant, go inside Timmy's, break some of that croissant, serve some bagels with someone. I plan on doing that with a young man there. And, you know, just be Jesus. Allow yourself to be part of the story. So thank you guys so much. We're going to pray. And then say hi to someone in the back. Don't run away. Okay? Dear God, thank you so much for today. Thank you for the opportunity to get to know you, to learn more about you, to hear more of the story that most of us have heard most of our lives, but not really think about too much because it's not really important. But Lord, there's so much more going on there. You were showing who you are, that you want to partner, and you were also showing what was coming. You were going to be broken for us. So not that we could just be fed for a meal, but we could be fed forever. Thank you, Jesus, for all you're doing for us. Thank you for all you've done. Please bless us this week. Bless our relationships. Bless our times together. And bring us back next week. And to support the team, give them safe travels, Lord. And get everyone here safely to bring us back next week. In Jesus' name, amen. And everyone said,
amen.
Thanks, guys.